Jackson. I really thought Congressman Kimball did kill his wife.
Fortunately, the jury didn't share your opinion.
Well, as I've told you, you'll have 90 seconds to tell our audience why they didn't.
Could be done in less.
Right now, if New York took an A-bomb, it would get a two-minute news bite between the weather report and a cat food commercial.
Gary said that this tie is a crime against humanity. Can I get a second opinion?
Oh, Chuck, Mr. Perry Mason. Chuck Gilmore, our sports guy.
I'm a longtime fan, and there's nothing wrong with that tie.
Thanks. I'm a big fan of yours, too. See you later.
Chuck, who's the obscenity around your neck, okay?
Twyla. Mr. Mason likes it.
Mr. Mason. We spoke on the phone on Twyla Cooper.
Our news director, brilliant, but a total tyrant.
A pleasure, Miss Cooper.
Well, I appreciate your being here.
Oh, Gillian Pope is a very persuasive young woman.
Twyla, I need you.
Oh, Brett, I'd like you to meet...
Now?
Sorry. Excuse me.
He's...
Not one of your favorites.
Well, it's 12 minutes to air. I need a touch-up. I understand you don't want any makeup?
Right. It wouldn't help.
Me neither, but I keep trying. Oh, Vic, do me a favor. Would you take Mr. Mason to the studio?
It'd be a pleasure.
I'm sending you first class. Vic St. John, our station manager. Perry Mason.
Right this way, Mr. Mason.
I'll see you on stage.
By the way, I spoke to Twyla. We cut your Mason piece.
To hell you did.
Oh, come on now. The Kimball case is old news. Besides, I need more time for my capital punishment piece.
I should have been consulted on this.
What, are you kidding? In the first place, this is not your show. And secondly,
your interview pieces,
they're about as inspiring as the traffic reports. That about does it, lady. You're through.
Yeah. Well, I think Vic will have something to say about that.
Oh, really? What do you think Vic's going to say?
He's going to say anything you want, Brett.
So if I were you, I'd start looking for another job, lady.
Or maybe another drug connection?
Oh, Mr. Mason.
Thought I'd say goodbye.
I guess you've been told.
Yes.
I'm so sorry.
Oh, no, it's all right.
Brett Houston is a world-class pig.
Oh, bad girl. You're insulting our pig viewers.
Okay, everybody, 2 minutes to air. Places, please.
Brett, I just got a call for you in the newsroom. A guy named Joe College.
Really, what did he want?
Oh, I left the message on your desk.
No, Brenda, I asked you what he wanted.
He said he got what you needed, and he wants you to meet him right after the show, on the sea-level parking lot in the Fashion Center Mall.
You still working on that Briggs College story? I thought that was a dead end.
Sure, I could probably wrap it up tonight. Chucky, looks like you might be back in the sports pages. How about that?
Brett, you're full of cow dung.
Come on, you love the publicity.
Okay, 5, 4... 3, 2, we're in titles. 30 seconds, everyone.
And now, KGGY's Channel 8 10 o'clock news with Denver's award-winning news team.
Fullback one.
Brent Houston. Gillian Pope. Chuck Gilmore with sports. And Gary Slate with the weather. Now, Denver's news as it happens. With tonight's top story, here's Brent Houston.
5, 4, 3, 2.
Good evening. Our top stories in the news tonight. The stalemate in the Mideast may be finally coming to an end. Leaders meet tomorrow in Cairo.
A woman who talks to horses and understands their thoughts. A special report from Golden, Colorado. Also, the highs and lows in the weather and sports, including highlights of tonight's Nuggets game in Denver.
And
Standby insert. Pull back. And the roll, Chiron.
The Nuggets crush the Jazz tonight, 105-88. Now, the Jazz lead the Nuggets by only two, with the Dallas Mavericks a game behind. The Houston Rockets are five back, and the San Antonio Spurs, despite their recent two-game sweep of the Celtics, remain nine games
and
behind.
And standby Baker.
And in the basement, the Minnesota Timberwolves. Brett?
Well, thank you, Chuck. Well, the Nuggets are in second place. You think they can do it this year?
We're coming on strong. If the Nuggets keep playing the way they did tonight, absolutely they could walk away with the title.
Great. Well, let's keep our fingers crossed, huh? And now recapping tonight's top story. A report from Cassie Woodfield still
out of a
brutal double murder, which took place earlier tonight at a Happy's hamburger stand in nearby Mountain View. Another in a string of apparently unrelated violent incidents which have plagued the fast food chain during the past year. Cassie?
Tonight, tragedy struck without warning in this normally quiet suburb. Two young people are dead, and police have no leads as to the killer or killers. Here's the scene earlier this evening. Two Mountain View High School students were shot to death in front of this fast food restaurant. Witnesses
we need to talk.
Driving by, slowed down,
we already talked.
Well, I think it's really important.
Yeah, to you, maybe.
Brett, please. I just need a couple of minutes.
There's no time. Their
names are currently being I need a word myself.
Sorry, I have an appointment later.
Like the shooting of another Happy's hamburger stand 3 months ago.
May I call you later? No
clues as to the identity of the
murderer. Well, it won't help.
Nor are they aware of any reason why these two young people were singled out to have their lives end so violently. The tragedy, of course, is that there probably wasn't any. Brett and Jillian, back to you.
Thank you, Cassie. A very good and very frightening report. Gare, I'll tell you what, could you look back into your crystal ball there for us and tell us what kind of a weekend we're going
to
have?
Be happy to, Brett. Weather-wise, is going to be a real beauty. As I reported earlier, we're locked into a mild weather pattern. So you should look for highs in the 60s, lows at night in the mid-40s. The important thing is get out there
stand
and enjoy
by one.
The weather while we still have it. Okay? Back to you, Brett.
Ah, thanks, Gare. And now from all of us at KGGY News.
Pull back and night. Roll, Chiron.
See you tomorrow.
Good night.
I have been trying and trying to reach you.
I turned the phone off. I've been working on my speech. Came in at 6.
You still going to that meeting in Kansas City?
My plane leaves at noon.
Well, I thought you'd stay around and so you could talk to the police.
Why?
Because you were there and everything.
Della, what are you talking about?
The morning newspaper. I'm sorry, I assumed you knew. Perry Mason's office. Oh, just 1 minute, please. Jillian Pope.
Hello? Yes, I'm reading about it now. All right, I'll be there in half an hour.
Yes, I hated him. But I certainly didn't kill him.
Tell me about this unusual language that you used in makeup.
Unusual? Ah, that. Well, you see, we had this argument about cutting your interview, as a matter of fact. And I sort of lost it for a minute.
And not for the first time.
I gather you know something of my sordid past.
I know you were a network news personality, that you developed a cocaine habit, and were probably fired because of it.
Yeah. Well, I guess it was just a case of too much too soon. Suddenly, I was in the big league and scared to death. A guy I was dating gave me some coke. I felt like there was nothing I couldn't do. And then I found I couldn't leave it alone. Funny thing, I wasn't fired because of coke. I was fired because I slapped my executive producer in the face, in front of everybody. They would probably have overlooked my habit, but not that. Anyhow, I've been through a recovery program, and I have been straight for over 2 years.
Tell me about the gun.
Well, it was stolen out of my car a few days ago. Along with my stereo, I did file a police report that same day.
Why do you have a gun?
Did a series on union corruption, got some pretty scary phone calls. Slut was the nicest thing they called me. So I bought a gun and I learned how to use it.
I understand Houston sent a memo demanding the station fire you.
I was number one on his hit list, but a lot of others were on that list too.
How do you know?
The memo got leaked somehow, and it was a work of art. He put the rap on everybody. Called me a washed-up cokehead, a disaster waiting to happen. So, my friend, have you any interest in representing a washed-up cokehead?
When Houston was murdered, where were you?
I went right home after the show, but except for my cat, there's nobody to back me up on that. I take it you're passing.
No, I'll be glad to represent you.
Thank you.
I will even look in on your cat. Now, if we can get you out on bail, you think Vic St. John will put up that bail?
Maybe. Now that Brett can't call all the shots. Mr. Mason, do you think I'll get out of this mess?
I certainly hope so. The world doesn't need another homeless cat.
Okay, thanks.
Lieutenant Brock.
Well, Mr. Mason, what's up, Counselor?
Jillian Pope said she reported her gun stolen a few days ago, and her stereo.
So you took the case, huh?
Yep.
Well, to each his own. Yeah, she reported those items stolen, but I thought that was part of her plan.
That's quite a stretch.
Mr. Mason, you see that officer I was just talking to? Well, he just found that allegedly stolen car stereo in a dumpster. Now, you want to guess where that dumpster was?
Near her apartment house.
Just right next to the back door. And my guess is her fingerprints will be all over it, which means that she took it out of the car herself. And, Counselor, the gun wasn't stolen. I think you picked yourself a real loser this time, sir.
Lieutenant, don't I always...
My wife's family bought this station 3 years ago and was getting ready to dive into Chapter 11. But, starting with the evening news, I got it all turned around.
How did you manage that?
By doing what every good executive does. I hired the best person I could find to do it for me, Twyla Cooper.
If I remember, she used to be a newscaster.
One of the best. As a matter of fact, she's taking over the anchor spot until this whole thing gets sorted out. Oh, by the way, don't worry about Jillian's bail. The station will put it up.
Good. Tell me about this memo Houston wrote.
Yeah. Well, since he's dead, and it was already leaked, I guess I'm not betraying a confidence.
Well, it's certainly blunt. On-air talent fired. What were you going to do about this?
I didn't want to do anything about it. But now, thank God, it's a dead issue. Sorry, I didn't mean it that way.
Looks more like an order than a suggestion.
Well, Brett liked to throw his weight around. The problem was, I felt that he was the real key to our getting back on top, and I usually gave in to most of his demands. I guess he figured I'd probably cave in on this one, too.
What made him the key?
Well, he was out to make a real rep for himself as a hard-hitting investigative reporter. He was damn good at it. But personally, he was a real lowlife. I mean, look here. He even took a cheap shot at his own wife in that thing.
He was married to Twyla Cooper?
More or less.
You mean I'd better ask her?
Well, it's nothing that I'm very proud of, but yes, I was married to him.
Before you came to KGGY?
No, no. Actually, I'd seen some tapes of Brett doing a sportscast in Miami. I went down there to check him out. He was, he was even better than he was on the tapes. You know, real star quality, handsome, sexy, intelligent. Came on to me like gangbusters. I don't know, maybe it's because I was pushing 40 and still single, but when he asked me to marry him, I couldn't get that yes out fast enough. Damnedest thing I ever did. Pro-lifers are going to be picketing city council tomorrow. I want Cassie out there, okay?
But you realized you'd made a mistake almost immediately.
I realized he couldn't keep his hands off of anything vaguely female. I finally walked when I found out he was sleeping with a young news writer here.
What happened to her?
Oh, he dumped her within a couple of weeks. Lately, he'd been betting down Cassie Woodfield. Maureen, we'll open with the hostage story and pick up the CNN lead.
Would it be fair to say that you hated Brett Houston?
Very fair, but who didn't?
Cassie Woodfield?
Oh, Mr. Mason. A little secret about women. Maybe men, too. Very possible to sleep with somebody and hate them at the same time.
Quote, Twyla Cooper is a humorless tyrant whose goal seems to be making the KGGY news as boring as possible.
Well, compared to what he said about the others, that's almost a tribute.
The point of this memo was to get you and the others fired.
Mr. Mason, are you implying that I might have killed Brett?
You had a reason. You think Miss Pope killed him?
No, but she also had a reason. Damn good reason. He wanted her out of here.
Unhappy with her work?
No, no. She was too good. Threatened his position as king of the news.
Were you there when the secretary gave Brett the phone message?
From Joe College? No, we were all there.
Then you knew where Houston was going to be after the show.
So I am a suspect.
No. But where were you at the time of Houston's murder?
I was driving home, alone. Not much of an alibi, is it? Do I need an alibi?
I thank you. There were at least a half a dozen people who knew exactly where Brett Houston was going after the show. And except for Vic St. John and the secretary, her name's Brenda Lim, everybody who knew where he'd be was also named in that memo.
This is some memo. He didn't pull any punches, did he? What about that guy who called? Joe College. I know. Find him.
Mason.
Harry Mason.
That's right.
I thought you'd like to know something. 6 months ago, Brett Houston took Gary Slate's girl away from her.
Who is this?
That doesn't matter. The girl was a news writer at the station. Slate took it pretty bad. He even talked about killing Houston.
Who was that?
Someone pointing me to Gary Slate.
Oh. Slate's appearing at the Comedy Cave tonight.
That is, after the news broadcast.
Ken, you know Cassie Woodfield?
Yeah, I've seen her on the tube. She's a knockout.
Talk to her tomorrow.
Perry, she couldn't have killed Houston. She was covering that drive-by shooting in Mountain View.
She was having an affair with him, and she might know something we should know.
Well, it's a dirty job, but for the good of the service, I'll do it.
Della, we're going nightclubbing.
So you see, the reason I became a weatherman is because that's all I ever hear from the girls I go out with. They always end up saying to me, Gary, I don't know whether we should see each other again. Which really hurts. But seriously, weather is my life. One giant cloud cover. I mean, recently I went out on a date. Now, I know I'm an unseasonably warm guy. But after a lovely evening, dinner, dancing, a movie, all I get is one massive cold front. To say nothing about the rest of her. Well, my time's almost gone here. I just want to remind you that you can see me every night on KGGY-TV, rain or shine. Thank you very much. You've been a great audience. Thank you. Here you go, Jeff.
Once again, Mr. AccuWeather, Gary. Gary, you have any idea how many times I've actually had to shovel partly cloudy off my sidewalk this year? Appreciate it, bud. Anyway.
God, I died up there. One of these days, I got to spring for a writer. Anyhow, you're Perry Mason, right? I saw you at the station the other night.
This is Della Street. She's the head of our office.
Right. Hello.
Hello. So, what do you want to see me about?
You were involved with a news writer at the station. I understand that Brett Houston took her away from him.
Yeah. What a guy.
What did you do about it?
I got over it.
Ever say anything about wanting to kill him?
Yeah, probably. You know how you just say things.
Oh, what happened to the girl?
Her? Moved to Aspen and shacked up with a guy who waxes skis for a living. Probably cheating on him by now.
Houston's memo. Gary Slate is a lightweight who knows nothing about the weather and even less about comedy. Mr. Slate, where were you at the time Brett Houston was murdered?
After the news? I came right here and did my act, which went a lot better that night than it did tonight. Why would you want to know that?
I don't think Jillian Pope killed Brett Houston. In fact, I'm sure she did not.
Wow. I'm glad I didn't talk to you before I went on. I mean, it's hard enough getting laughs out there without knowing that someone in your audience thinks you're a cold-blooded killer.
Channel 8 News. That's it. Just get a shot of one of the ladies with a stroller and we'll be out of here.
Ms. Woodfield, my name's Ken Malansky. I'm an associate of Perry Mason's.
Hi. Is it true he's defending Jillian Pope?
Yeah.
He looks great. Hank Rossiter, my engineer. Sam Garza, my cameraman.
Pleasure to meet you. Hey.
What can I do for you?
Can I talk to you for a few minutes? I can drive you back.
All right. Hank, you guys go on ahead. I've got plenty of time for the edit.
Buy you a cup of coffee.
Black would be fine, thanks.
Sure.
So, what do you want to know?
How well do you know Brett Houston?
How well did I know Brett Houston?
Yeah.
The answer is better than I should have. I'll take my coffee first.
Okay. Maybe we should start from the top.
Okay, from the top. Well, I used to be a model from the time I was about 14. And probably would have been washed up by the time I was 30 if Twyla hadn't spotted me in this dumb jeans commercial. Still don't know how, but she figured maybe I had a brain, too. She brought me out here, put a microphone in my hand, told me to go out and pretend I was Jane Pauley.
And Brett Houston?
Well, here was this media star who treated me like a real reporter, like I had a real mind. What did I do? I rolled over like a puppy.
Man, but you don't exactly seem to be wallowing in grief.
It ended weeks ago.
What happened?
I guess I finally grew up.
Think Jillian killed Brett?
I don't know who killed Brett.
Somebody did. Quite possibly somebody you work with.
It's funny, you know, you never think anyone you know could actually commit a cold-blooded murder, but...
You know what Brett wrote about you in his memo.
That I was a Barbie clone with a brain as plastic as her body? Shows what a snake he was. There isn't an ounce of plastic in my body, and he knew that better than anyone else.
I believe it.
Thanks. Now, we better get me back to the station.
Of course.
Look. If you're not seeing anybody right now, I thought maybe some night we could have dinner.
I'd like that.
I'd like that too.
You know, I was right. The only prints on that stereo belong to your client.
But that's not why you called me down here.
No, there's someone I want you to meet. We're getting a statement now. Mr. Davidson, will you be good enough to briefly tell Mr. Mason what you told me earlier?
Yes. Of course, it was just the other night, 2211. That was the Fashion Mall parking garage. Picking up my daughter, she was there in the movie. And as I was driving out, Jillian Pope was driving in.
2211, and witnesses heard the shots at a quarter of? Sorry about that, Mr. Mason.
Brett's forgiveness.
Look, Jillian, I like you. I believe in you. But one more lie and you'll have to look for another lawyer. You understand?
Yes.
What did you see at the garage?
Well, when I got to level C, I saw a crowd gathering. I got out of the car. Brett was just lying there on the cement. That's all I saw.
What did you do then?
I heard some sirens. And I got the hell out of there. I passed a couple of police cars and an ambulance coming up the ramp, and I guess the guy who saw me drive in.
Go on.
Brett's memo? The one that got leaked? I'm the one who leaked. Brenda told me about it, and I got her to access it from Brett's computer. And I left a copy on the desks of everyone who was mentioned in the memo. I wish I hadn't done it. If one of them killed Brett, then maybe I am responsible for his death, even if I didn't pull the trigger.
I think we have to worry more about the people who say you did pull the trigger.
I mean it. I think I'm in love.
Here.
What's this?
Names and dates of the last 12 times you've said, I think I'm in love.
What did she say about Houston?
Just what everybody else says, that he's a sleaze. I mean, but who cares? I mean, it's the way that she said it.
Did she also tell you that she's going out with Gary Slate? Here's the info on our new friends. You better check the Gilmore file first.
She's really going out with that weatherman?
Oh, Ken. Perry Mason's office. Oh, just a minute, Lieutenant. Rock.
Yes, Ed. When? We'll be right down. Well, they just arrested your rival.
Gary Slate?
Caught him trying to break into Brett Houston's condo.
Well, I knew he wasn't good enough for her. Can I keep that?
What? I wrote Brett the kind of letter that you write and then have the good sense not to mail. Well, I mailed it. And then when I realized that you were trying to prove somebody besides Jillian was the murderer, I got scared. I thought if my letter turns up, I'm going to be number one on the suspect list.
So you went to Houston's condo to get it back?
I had no idea the police sealed the place off. And that is all there was to it. But if you're really looking for somebody else who may have killed Brett...
We're not.
I tried Chuck Gilmore. He almost knocked Brett's brains out a couple weeks ago.
After he signs his statement, take him back to the holding cell.
You believe him about that letter?
I don't believe him. Certainly wanted something in Houston's condo.
My guys went over that place like spandex.
Whatever happened to fine-tooth combs? Mind if Ken has a try?
Yeah, as long as one of my guys go along.
I'll call you in the morning. Set up a time.
All right.
Oh, Mr. Mason. You must think I'm moonlight as a bail bondsman. This time I'm here for Gary Slate.
Okay, Mr. St. John, let's see if we can't dig you up a judge. I'll check them all out.
But pay very close attention to Houston's place.
You got any idea what I'm looking for?
Maybe the real name of Joe College, maybe something else. Houston was a very complex man. And complex men keep complex secrets.
In other words, you've got no idea.
Not a clue.
I could have told you that.
I checked every closet and drawer in this place.
So did we. Hey, you're blocking the set.
Oh, sorry. I wouldn't want you to miss Heather hitting on her stepfather.
Step-uncle.
Right. You guys see this?
But she's carrying my...
In the box, it says Nightly News, October 5th, 1990. But on the inside, it's a commercial porno called Motel Madam.
Worst skin flick I ever saw.
Sorry, Heather, then I won't play it.
It looks a lot worse than it is, but we have it completely under control now.
Thanks very much, Kat.
Bet.
Non-story. Let's wrap it up and get out of here. Hi.
Got a minute?
Sure. Maybe get a little more footage just in case, huh?
A couple more shots, thanks.
Okay.
Nobody else has seen these yet. I'm afraid I'm going to have to keep those.
Where'd they come from?
Houston's apartment.
I owe you an explanation.
No, you don't.
Yes, I would like to. Remember I told you I'd been modeling since I was a kid? Well, when I was about 17 and really hungry, I got suckered into posing for those. I mean, the guy seemed like a real pro. When he asked me to do some art studies, I didn't want to come off like some dumb high school kid, which of course I was. So I said, okay. The next day, when he showed me the pictures, I realized what I'd done. I got hysterical. He didn't know I was a minor, and he panicked. Anyway, he said that he wouldn't publish them if I wouldn't tell anyone he took them. That was about 8 years ago, and I thought it was all over. And one day, Brett showed up with those pictures.
Where'd he find them?
I don't know. But the guy was a closet porno freak. I guess there are places where guys like that can buy that stuff.
Why'd he show them to you? What'd he want?
He wanted me.
That's why you had the affair with him.
Well, what was I going to do? I mean, if those ever came out, I'd be through. So I went along.
You didn't tell anybody about it? How he blackmailed you?
I told Gary. Asked him if he could think of a way to get the pictures back. Now he's in trouble, and it's my fault.
Gary will be okay. Without the police, will even press charges. Paramedics say he was killed instantly, so at least he didn't suffer. I wonder if Garza noticed anything wrong with the truck. Where is he?
I don't know. One of the cops was asking him some questions before, but then he just took off.
He looked pretty shook.
He and Hank worked together for years.
Mr. Polanski? I'll be right back. Anything you can tell me about this, Lieutenant?
Anything you can tell me. You were here.
Yeah, I was talking to Miss Woodfield, and all of a sudden the truck just blew.
Bomb squad found fragments of an explosive device.
You mean like a time bomb?
Or it could have been detonated by a remote control. Anybody around when it went off?
Yeah, 20 or 30 people.
Did you recognize anybody?
No.
Well, in that case, if it was remote control, it could have been anybody.
Got to be related to the Brett Houston murder.
It's either that or the god of television has got it in for KGGY.
Lieutenant Brock, this is dispatch. Come in, please.
Thanks.
Yeah, Ed Brock here.
So I went to Brett, and I begged him to give them back to her.
And he refused.
After he was killed, I thought I could get them back before the cops found them. Cassie's a great kid. I was trying to help her.
Some people might get the idea that if you'd steal from Miss Woodfield, maybe you'd kill for her.
That's nuts. I couldn't kill anybody.
After the program that night, you went right to the comedy cave to do your act.
Right, I told you so.
So, it turns out you didn't appear on stage until nearly 11:30. The news ended at 10:30. Houston was killed at 10:45.
Yeah, well, what happened was I got to the cave, and I found out several acts had been scheduled before me. So I went and grabbed a cup of coffee.
Where?
At a coffee shop right next door. I tried out a couple of my jokes on a waitress, and I was back at the cave at 11:15. I did my act.
I hope that waitress remembers your jokes. Oh, do you know where I can find a secretary here named Brenda Lim?
Yeah, she's down to the right by assignments.
Thank you.
Okay,
Lynn? Mm-hmm. My name is Mason. I'm representing Julian Pope.
I know.
You're fond of Julian, aren't you?
Yeah, she's really a super lady.
She told me that you got Brett Houston's memo for her.
Please don't tell anybody. I could get into a lot of trouble.
Don't worry. But I wonder if you'd get something else out of Houston's computer files. It might really help you.
Sure, I guess so. Come on, I can access his files over here. What are you looking for?
I'll know it when I see it.
Okay, here it comes.
That one, Briggs College. Can you print that out for me? Also, the one called St. John.
Okay.
Mr. Shockley?
My name is Mason. I'd like to talk to you. The murder of Brett Houston. Well, whatever you say, but unless I can see you, I'll have to notify the police. No, 50-yard line. I'll see you there at noon.
Here's Briggs College in St. John.
Thank you very much. Brenda, you've been a great help.
Yeah, do you have a flight 105 leaving at 9? 9 p.m., I think. Los Angeles. Okay, thanks a lot. And the page behind the one he tore out has these very slight indentations in it. He must have been looking for some possible rentals in Los Angeles. Now all I have to do is find a matching edition of the paper, overlay the two pages, and we got it.
How many of the little marks are there?
About 25.
So what we have is 25 possible places that Garza may be renting in Los Angeles.
Well, he lived there until he moved here to Denver. In fact, his ex-wife is still there. They were divorced 8 years ago. The rest is all here.
Ken, I want you on a plane to Los Angeles. We need Garza. He's a material witness in the Rossiter bombing. The local police may also want him back, but it won't hurt for us to get a head start.
I'm packed.
And then they fired me on account they said I was guilty of illegal recruiting practices.
Were you?
You serious, man? I was an assistant coach. So if I promised some muscle-bound farm kid a new car or something for enrolling in Briggs, it's because they told me to.
You were trying to get back at the college by feeding Houston the drug and gambling story.
Maybe, but it's still true. It's been going on for years. Those kids pop steroids like they were jelly beans. And they bet on themselves, too.
sometimes against themselves when they figure they can't beat the spread.
And you didn't call Houston the night he was killed?
Must have been somebody else using that dumb code name Houston gave.
According to the story you were giving Houston, Chuck Gilmore used steroids in college and to this day supplies them to the kids.
Yeah, and he was pretty heavy into gambling, too.
You liar! Tell the man you're lying.
I'm not lying.
Tell the truth! Are you a fake?
I was lying. Houston was paying me for the start. And he gave me an extra $5 to say he was part of it.
When did he do this?
A couple of weeks before he was killed.
Mason, you satisfied now?
I'm satisfied you're a man who's prone to violence.
Mr. Mason? Hi, how's it going? For Jillian, I mean.
We'll find out tomorrow, Miss Cooper. Oh. By the way, that remote of the drive-by shooting?
At Happy's Hamburgers.
Is it possible it wasn't live, but a tape that was made earlier?
Well, part of it was tape, but the wraparound was certainly live. I mean, I was in the control room. I could see Cassie on the location waiting for her cue. What do you want to know?
Just trying to eliminate possible suspects.
Have I been eliminated yet?
Are you a suspect?
Mr. Mason, if you're really looking for somebody capable of murder, you might think about Gary Slate or Chuck Gilmore.
Why?
I'm not making any accusations, but neither of them is what I would call emotionally stable.
As opposed to a woman who marries an absolute stranger.
Excuse me, Mr. Mason.
Yes, it's true. I was convicted on charges of embezzlement. But that was 20 years ago in Chicago, and it was my partner who rigged the books. I just couldn't prove it.
But Houston found out about it.
As I told you, he was a top investigative reporter.
And he used that information as a club to run your news department any way he wanted. Did you know Houston intended to file a challenge to your FCC license renewal? A challenge based on the fact that you concealed your conviction when you applied for the license initially? Mr. St. John, the FCC served you with a notice of intent to file a challenge 8 weeks ago.
All right, so I knew. What about it?
Where were you at the time Brett Houston was murdered?
I was home. I went right there after the 10 o'clock news.
That verifiable?
My wife was out of town. Look, if you're so sure that Jillian didn't murder Brett, then Twyla's your best bet. I mean, Brett made a complete fool out of her. And Twyla's not the sort of person to let anybody get away with that.
Thank you.
You're way off base about me, Mason. Way off.
Not the first time.
Yeah, I matched the page of classifieds. I've checked 10 of the places so far, but no Garza.
You'll have to keep at it.
Okay, but it may take me a couple of days. I'm saving the ex-wife as a last resort.
We don't have much time, but be careful. We found out Garza is a demolitions expert.
Okay, I'll call back as soon as I get a lead. If I don't get blown up first.
Ken, call back even if you do. Jenner, you examined People's Exhibit 2, the revolver registered to Miss Pope and found at the murder scene. Were her fingerprints on the weapon?
No. Either she wiped the gun clean or, more likely, wore gloves when she fired it.
You also examined People's Exhibit 12, the car stereo conveniently found in a dumpster near her apartment.
Yes.
Did you find fingerprints on that?
Yes, the defendant's.
Now, that stereo was a pull-out type, so we'd expect to find her fingerprints on it, wouldn't we?
Yes, we'd expect to find her prints, but if the stereo was stolen along with the gun a couple of days before the murder, like she claimed...
Then the thief's prints would have been on it, too.
Exactly.
In other words, the defendant could wear gloves, but nobody else would. No further questions.
And you're positive the woman you saw drive into the Fashion Center garage at 10:40 on the evening of October 14th was the defendant Jillian Pope?
Oh, yes, sir. I'm a big fan of hers. I'd know her anywhere.
That's all, Your Honor.
You may cross-examine, Mr. Mason.
Mr. Davidson, you say you exited the Fashion Center garage at 10:40 p.m. How can you be so sure of the time?
Well, I was surprised to see Miss Pope there. I imagined that, the newscast was still going on, so I checked my watch. It said 20 of 11. And, of course, the newscast ends at 10:30.
And, of course, your watch is accurate.
Oh, I hadn't lost a minute in 6 years.
You testified you were picking your daughter up from a movie. What film was it?
It was Death Cop 2. It's the comedy, really.
According to the theater manager on that evening, Death Cop 2 started at 8:45 p.m. and ended precisely at 10:39 p.m. Where did you meet your daughter?
In the mall outside the theater.
Oh, you had to go down two levels to your car and then drive out. How long would you estimate that took?
Maybe 5 minutes.
Since the film ended at 10:39, you would have left the garage at 10:44, not at 10:40, as you testified.
I guess so. So what?
Well, the shots were reported at exactly 10:45 by three separate witnesses. That means that at the most, the defendant would have had 1 minute or less to drive up two parking levels, find Mr. Houston, and fire the fatal bullets into him. Your Honor, no further questions.
I'm sorry, but I just rented that apartment yesterday.
Yesterday?
Yes, to a very nice young man.
Well, how young?
Around 40.
Big guy?
Yes, is he a friend of yours?
Yeah, as a matter of fact, I think he is.
Well, it's apartment 2 right down there.
Thanks.
Yeah? I think maybe I have the wrong place.
Yes, we all read the memo.
Miss Woodfield, did you ever hear Mr. Slate, Miss Cooper, or Mr. Gilmore consequently express any opinions about Mr. Houston?
Well, they were very angry at him. We all were.
Can you tell us specifically what each of them may have said about Mr. Houston?
Objection, Your Honor. Calls for hearsay.
Going to state of mind, Your Honor.
State of mind may be relevant here, Mr. Mason, but it seems to me you're attempting to prove motive rather than a state of mind. For that reason, the objection will be sustained.
I've no more questions.
Now, Miss Woodfield, since Mr. Mason has opened up this can of peas, can you tell the court what the defendant might have said about Mr. Houston?
Well, she was mad, too, of course.
Miss Woodfield, we've heard evidence that the defendant physically attacked a producer on a prior job and that she threw a heavy jar of cold cream at Mr. Houston's head shortly before his murder. Now, Surely you must have heard such a short-tempered woman expressing opinions about Mr. Houston.
Objection to the characterization of the defendant as short-tempered?
Sustained.
Miss Woodfield, I'm specifically referring to something the defendant said to you a week before the murder when she was giving you a ride home.
Oh, that. Well, she had been at the firing range that afternoon. When she bought the gun that she had, she wanted to learn how to use it properly. Anyhow, she said that each time she aimed at the target, she imagined that it was Brett's face.
Thank you.
Redirect, Your Honor.
Proceed.
Miss Woodfield, isn't it true that even before Mr. Houston's memo, you knew he was trying to get the defendant fired?
Yes.
Isn't it also true that after the memo, Twyla Cooper told you that if Miss Pope did lose her job, you would stand a good chance of taking her place as co-anchor?
Well, Twyla said that she might try me out, yeah.
No further questions.
Witness may step down.
Garza!
Something wrong?
No. Actually, I'm looking for your ex-husband.
Sam? What for?
Legal business.
Well, I haven't seen Sam for years.
I have information he's back in L.A. Has he been in touch, called you or anything?
What kind of legal business?
He's a witness to a murder in Colorado. I need to ask him some questions.
That's it.
That's what?
Nothing. Look, I don't know where Sam is, and I don't really care.
What's going on here? A peep show? Cover yourself up, for God's sakes. Now, what's going on?
He was asking about Sam.
Oh, this creep again, eh? Twice in 1 week.
What, you saw him?
No, and we're not gonna. I told him to keep his butt away from here.
When'd you tell him?
Are you a cop or something? You got a warrant to ask these questions?
No, I'm an attorney.
Oh, good. Then you can get out of here now.
Look, it's very important to me that I find this guy.
And that's your problem, right?
Yeah.
You can find your way out, huh? What do you do when I'm not here? Answer the door stark naked?
What are you always so jealous about? He couldn't see nothing.
Houston was to meet Joe College immediately after the broadcast at the Fashion Center garage. Several witnesses say you were just behind Houston when Miss Lim relayed that message.
Okay, I heard it. But after the news, I went directly to the Comedy Cave and did my routine.
Oh, Mr. Slate, that was at 11:30, not 10:30 p.m. Mr. Gilmore, you went to Briggs College. I understand Mr. Houston was working on a drug and gambling scandal there.
Well, it had nothing to do with me.
Isn't it true Mr. Houston was paying a Briggs employee, a Mr. Al Shockley, to incriminate you in the college scandal by lying about you?
Objection, Your Honor. Relevance. Mr. Mason is trying the deceased.
I certainly wouldn't want to do that, Your Honor. We apologize for bringing this up, Mr. St. John. But isn't it true that Brett Houston had knowledge about your past that might result in the loss of your FCC license?
Your Honor, I object to Mr. Mason's blackening people's reputations.
I withdraw the question. Brett Houston's memo demanding that almost everyone be fired was the talk of the office, wasn't it?
Oh, to say the least. Everybody expected problems.
Whatever Brett Houston demanded, management usually gave him, correct?
Yes. And as I said, we were all worried.
But only you were the beneficiary of a $500,000 insurance policy on the life of Brett Houston.
What are you saying?
Well, as part of your divorce settlement from Mr. Houston, you remained the irrevocable beneficiary on his life insurance policy?
I resent your insinuation.
I've no more questions.
Mr. LaRusso?
No questions, Your Honor.
The witness is excused. This court will stand adjourned till 10 o'clock tomorrow morning.
You want something?
Can I talk to you alone for a minute?
Rich, go take a look at that prelude. So?
Well, I just wanted to apologize for this. I wasn't trying to...
Hey,
you know how...
I know it wasn't your fault.
Well, thanks. Your wife tell you Garza's involved in a murder back in Colorado?
No, she said he called to hit her up for some dough. Said he had to leave town before he picked up his last check.
Well, he had to leave town and face charges. You mind?
No, go ahead. You know that stupid dame was going to give it to him, too. My money. I still think she has an itch for this guy.
Yeah, that's nice. Look, you seem like a pretty good guy, so maybe you ought to know something. Before he left Colorado, Garza told some people the reason he was coming to L.A. was to try and get a lease back.
You serious?
That's what they said.
Look, if you found him, you'd take him back there?
That's why I'm in L.A.
And he might stand trial for murder, huh?
Yeah.
I got his number in the office. Come on.
Here, Garza. Dave Franco. Yeah, I thought it over. I'm going to give you that $1,000. On one condition. You never try to see or talk to my wife again. You understand? All right. There's a bar at Western and Ashby. I'll meet you there tonight at 8 o'clock. I don't know nothing funny about it. I just don't want you anywhere near my house. Okay, I'll see you there. It's all yours.
Thanks a lot.
Right, Della. Yes, I have that. Della, just hold on. Could you run that again from the top of the intro? And could you make it larger?
We'll lose some of it.
It's all right.
Excuse me. I have a show to prepare here. When are you going to be through?
As soon as possible, but as I told you, this could be very important to Jillian's case.
Really? As important as making me look as if I killed Brett for his damn insurance?
If you didn't, don't worry.
Just let me me know when he's through, all right?
There. Can you keep that going? And can I get a copy of that blown up?
Sure. Let me see if the boss says it's okay.
Well, Della, now we know how Brett Houston was murdered. We also know who did it.
Appreciate what you guys are doing.
Hey, we didn't volunteer for this gig. Captain said to pick this guy up on a warrant, so that's what we're doing. Want a donut?
Is that all you guys ever eat?
Hey, we got it. See? It's in the oven.
That's him.
You stay here.
Sam Garza, LAPD.
Touch the wire!
Anything more from Ken?
Not since he called last night.
Is the defense ready?
Check the airline. Maybe there was fog in L.A.
I checked. No fog.
Mr. Mason.
Oh, sorry, Your Honor. Defense is ready.
Would you please call your next witness?
I call Cassie Woodfield.
Your Honor, Miss Woodfield's already been dismissed.
Miss Woodfield has been re-subpoenaed by the defense. We wish to examine her as a hostile witness.
Permission granted.
Is it true that Mr. Houston was in possession of certain photographs of you?
Do I have to answer that?
Objection, Your Honor. I see no relevancy in defense counsel's continuing to blacken the reputations of innocent people.
Your Honor, these questions are extremely relevant to the defense.
I'll overrule the objection, Mr. Mason, but this court's patience can sometimes erode to the point of being very, very thin. So beware.
Yes, Your Honor. Miss Woodfield, I have no intention of introducing the photographs unless you deny their existence.
Okay, yes, he had pictures of me. They were taken when I was 17 years old.
And did Mr. Houston use those photographs to blackmail you into having sexual relations with him?
You obviously know he did. But if you're trying to say that I killed Brett, you also know that I couldn't have. I was in Mountain View until 10:30 that night on a remote.
Covering a drive-by shooting at Happy's Hamburgers.
That's right. I was on live TV 30 miles away. There were thousands of witnesses. There's no way I could have gotten back here by 10:45.
That night, Sam Garza was your minicam operator, and the late Hank Rossiter was your engineer, is that correct?
Yes.
Your Honor, per stipulation with the prosecution, I would like permission now to set up the video demonstration we requested.
Very well. Are you through with this witness?
Not yet, Your Honor.
Ms. Whitfield, would you step down and take a seat in the courtroom, please?
Your Honor, these are the last few minutes from the KGGY-TV newscast, the night of Brett Houston's murder.
Mr. Mason, surely you're not implying that this drive-by shooting had anything to do with the murder of Mr. Houston, are you?
Not at all, Your Honor. Your Honor, we're about to show you a blow-up of the section we just saw of the newscast. This part of Miss Woodfield's coverage was taped earlier in the evening at approximately 8 p.m. I asked the court to note that in this earlier coverage, the apostrophe in the neon sign is strobing slightly. Again, this is the original tape of the newscast. What we're about to play for you now is a blow-up of a part of Miss Woodfield's remote when she was broadcasting live.
Tonight, tragedy struck.
This time, Your Honor, you will see that the apostrophe is not strobing.
Mr. Mason, this has been mildly entertaining, but it has certainly failed to be very enlightening. I must ask you to get to the point.
Your Honor, I call Detective Lieutenant Ed Brock.
Well, all the Happy's hamburgers are built pretty much to the same plan. Buildings, the signs, everything's about the same. In fact, they even close at the same time, 9:30 p.m.
You find anything unusual at either of the two branches you investigated?
At the local Pine Avenue branch of the Happy's hamburgers, we found traces of chalk mark in the parking lot. And the marks were similar to the ones that we used when we marked the locations of bodies doing an investigation. Someone tried to scuff those marks out.
Any recent homicides at that Pine Avenue branch?
Nope.
And did you observe any problems with the neon sign there?
You mean, like, was the apostrophe strobing? No, the sign appeared to be in perfect working order.
How far is the Pine Avenue branch from the Fashion Center garage?
About a mile and a quarter.
Perhaps a five-minute drive?
5 minutes or less.
That's all. Thank you.
Lieutenant Brock, what prompted you to investigate these other Happy's hamburgers?
Mr. Mason suggested it.
Mr. Mason. Your Honor, I find the introduction of this evidence to be highly irregular.
Now, just a minute. Mr. Mason showed me the tapes with the discrepancy in the neon signs, and I agreed with him that an investigation of other Happy's hamburgers would be appropriate.
I still object to this testimony, Your Honor.
On what grounds?
Oh, Mr. LaRusso, I hope you're not about to imply there's been any falsifying of evidence.
I withdraw the objection.
That's all. Thank you very much. I recall Cassie Woodfield. Miss Woodfield, why did you leave Mountain View where the drive-by shooting occurred, then do your live broadcast from the already closed hamburger stand on East Pine Street? In other words, why did you fake the location?
I didn't fake anything. You can ask Sam Garza. He'll tell you.
But what if I told you that at 11:30 last night at the Queen of Angels Hospital in Los Angeles, Sam Garza died as a result of a tragic accident? Miss Woodfield, defense believes you may be guilty of murder. If indeed you did kill Brett Houston, you certainly needed an alibi. So when you got the drive-by shooting assignment, you improvised brilliantly. You gave Garza and Rossiter some reason to fake the location, probably told them about the photographs, that you needed time to get them from Houston's condo. After the murder, you had to turn your attention to Garza and Rossiter.
I will not listen to any more of these lies. I didn't kill anybody. And faking the location was Sam's idea.
What was his reason?
He said he had to be back in town by 10:30, and nobody would know the difference. He's the one that killed Brett. After Brett died, he threatened both of us, Hank and me. We were real scared of him. Did you know that Sam was a demolitions expert in Vietnam?
You knew about Sam and Vietnam?
Yes. He had told me about it. We used to be very close.
Do you also know that he purchased a large quantity of gelignite 2 days before Hank Rossiter was killed?
Well, you see, that proves it. Sam did it. He killed Brett and Hank.
Why didn't you go to the police after Hank Rossiter was killed?
I was afraid that Sam would kill me, too. He was a lunatic. You told me he was dead.
No. I merely said, what if I told you he was dead? Miss Lee, would you please read back the last question and answer?
Question. Why didn't you go to the police after Hank Rossiter was killed? Answer. I was afraid Sam would kill me, too. He was a lunatic.
I must warn you, Miss Woodfield, that on the stand, Mr. Garza will tell a substantially different story.
I don't care what he says. He's the one that killed them.
He is a liar.
You thought you had Garza completely under your control. On the night of the murder, you convinced Garza to phone in a fake message from Joe College. You told Garza you had to delay Houston's return home so you could retrieve certain photographs. What you really wanted from him was to lure Houston to the spot where you shot and killed him. You left Jillian Pope's gun at the scene and planted the stereo in her dumpster. Rossiter threatened to blow your alibi, didn't he? So you had Mr. Garza rig explosives just to give the old man a scare. But when Rossiter was actually killed by you, Garza panicked and left town.
I couldn't have killed Hank. I was talking to him when the van blew up.
Mr. Malansky will testify that at the moment the truck exploded, you seemed to be fishing for a tissue in your purse. No tissue, but a very convenient detonator. This detonator, marked Exhibit 5A for identification. Now, I show you a pair of gloves. Marked Exhibit 5B for identification. Are they yours?
I think they're mine.
Oh, they are indeed. They are the same gloves you wore that night. We all saw them on the telecast. Now, you won't be surprised when the police testify that they found powder burns on those gloves, will you? Because you wore those same gloves when you shot Brett Houston. You won't be surprised, will you?
I didn't kill anybody, not Hank, not Brett. Please, you've got to believe me.
I wish I could. I wish I could, Miss Woodfield. But you are a cold-blooded killer. You framed Jillian Pope for the murder of Brett Houston. Framed her only because you wanted her job. And a few moments ago, you tried to frame Sam Garza for the murder of Hank Rossiter. No. No. You are a cold-blooded. You did kill Hank Rossiter, did you not?
Yes.
You did murder Brett Houston, did you not?
Yes.
Cold-blooded murderer.
Yes.
Your Honor, I move to dismiss all charges against the defendant.
Does the district attorney have any objections?
No objection, Your Honor.
Motion granted, Mr. Mason. The defendant will be released from custody, and I order the bailiffs to place under arrest Cassie Woodfield and Sam Garza and charge them with first-degree murder.
This chair and proudly present our permanent and sole anchor person, the finest television journalist I know, Jillian Pope.
Thank you, Twan. Here, Chuck.
Topping the news this evening is the arrest of former KGGY reporter Cassie Woodfield for the murder of Brett Houston, also a former member and anchor person.
Haven't you had enough of the news? We missed dinner, and I'm hungry.
I'm fine. Great food.
Lucky you got the idea she was broadcasting from another place.
Oh, lucky Houston talked about the hamburger fast food chain.
I'm hungry.
I'm buying. Great place.
Oh, but Perry.
Greatest hamburgers in town.